those of you on the Zoom call, if you want to raise your hand using the raise your hand feature, I will call on you. There is no public comment. Okay, then I declare the public comment period closed. And the next item on our agenda is field trip requests. So we have three field trips that are being requested, and they are our traditional trips. So we have the first trip is Justine Flora, and it is the high school DECA club who will be going to Boston to compete March 9th through March 11th. And all of the information is in your packet. So it's an overnight trip, so it needs your approval. The next is Take Flight, which is Mr. Smith at the Lane School, which is also out of state. It is a day trip. It's an opportunity for the Lane students to go up to a ropes course up in Kittery, Maine. And then finally, Nature's Classroom, which is up in Freedom, New Hampshire, returning to its fall weekend, which is our more typical. And that would be October 25th through 27th. And as I say, these are all traditional trips, which we have taken in the past. And I'm happy to answer any questions on any of the trips.
Sarah Scoville, any questions, comments, or anything else?
I don't have any questions until I did that. We're back to these trips. So.
Did anybody else hear her through Zoom? I'm not hearing her.
Hello?
Yeah, I can hear
you. Yeah, okay, we see me.
I'm delighted that these trips are back happening.
Okay, great. And I have no comments either, so then I think we can take a vote.
We can do one at a time, right?
We can do it one at a time if you want, sure.
I think I have to.
Would you like to make a motion, Mr. Fresco?
I move we approve the trip for the DECA competition in Boston on March 9th through March 11th, 2023, at no cost to the school.
Thank you. To the district, yeah.
District.
Second to the motion, please.
Second.
Thank you. All right, we'll kill vote. Sarah?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
Sheila?
Yes.
Ann?
Yes.
And I am a yes. Motion passes 5-0. Another motion on trips?
We approve the trip to Take Flight in Kittery, Maine on May 15th to 16th, 2023, at no cost to the district.
Any second to that motion?
Second.
All right, we'll call the vote. Sarah?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
Sheila?
Yes.
Ann?
Yes.
Brad? 5-0. And another motion?
Enthusiastically move we approve the trip to Nature's Classroom on October 25th to 27th, 2023, at no cost to the district.
Is there a second?
Second.
And then we'll take a roll call vote. Sarah?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
Sheila?
Yes.
Ann?
Yes.
And Brad votes yes. And that makes us all three motions pass 5-0. That concludes this item on our agenda. We're going to move next to the superintendent's goals, the second week. And this is for you, Mr. Conley.
Thank you. It's been kind of delayed because of all of our talk about budget, but the superintendent's goals, the last time we were here, we talked about academic excellence, and Mr. Brosco in particular wanted to make sure that that was incorporated into the goals, and it has been. So I submit the goals amended from our earlier discussions. And I'm happy to walk through them if people would like me to, but I know you have them in your packet.
All right, so no, turn it off. In that case, I'll start with Sarah.
I don't have any additional questions.
All right, Dan?
This presentation is extremely effective. It'd be very helpful in our evaluation process, matching it to the areas that we're assessing. Phyllis, I really appreciate it. I wish you much success as you seek to complete them over the next few months. I have no questions.
All right, thank you, Dan. Sheila.
No, Phil, thank you for the update. No questions.
And Ann?
No questions.
Okay, and I have no questions. So I believe that means we are ready to actually let's see if Sarah McGinley has any questions. And Sarah McGinley, shake her hand. And Laura? says on the agenda vote, that's why.
Oh, that's right.
Yes, I don't think they were approved because we had the addition that was wanted.
Yes, right.
Okay. So we do need a motion, Phil, so just.
Please.
Yes, all right, so.
I move we approve the superintendent's goals as amended.
Thank you, is there a second?
Second.
All right, now we can have our roll call vote, thank you, Sarah?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
Sheila?
Yes.
Ann?
Yes.
And Brad, I vote yes, so that passes 5-0-0. That brings us to the residency policy, and Phil, maybe you could tell us a little bit about what's going on here, what the changes are.
Absolutely, so thank you, Brad. Our current policy, and we're talking about residency policy, so it's JFA-E, which is our residency policy, was last approved June 15th of 2004. So it's been a little while since we looked at our residency policy. The new policy, which has been sent through our legal department, updates our policies, is very specific about making sure that we are servicing the students of Bedford, the students of Boston for our Medco program, and the students of Hanscom who are residents on Hanscom Air Force Base. It also gives us some new language around McKinney-Vento, which is the Homeless Students Act. It also helps the principals to make sure that changes in residency are noted by the principals in the different schools. It also gives us control over our non-resident students, and in that case, we're talking about our students who are coming in from international students, particularly those coming in through programs. So those are limited. We would like through this residency policy to limit that to Rotary and AFS, two very well-known programs who do a great job for both the school and for the student who's coming in. And so that's the update, and you can see the references. The policy has been cross-referenced by our attorneys, and so this is our first read to update the residency policy. So I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Okay, let's start with Sarah Scogo.
Thank you. I have a question about the McKinney-Vento. Ann and I were familiar with this, but sort of the other way around. When families lived in Bedford, they were put here in temporary housing from the state. So they weren't residents, but they were allowed to come to the school. I understand that. But many of them were bused back to their home districts. So that's what the McKinney-Vento is meant to do. That if they live, no. All right, excuse me. Sorry.
Okay. So, yeah, so the McKinney-Vento Act really is about students who, there's a whole bunch of parts to it. The parts that you're talking about where students would live in Bedford and then maybe be bused through a state program, and that's about to happen to one of our neighbor towns. That is superseded because it's a state agency that's placing students and then placing them for education purposes. So it's not really the same. McKinney-Vento is for a family who lives in Bedford or lives in a neighboring town and finds itself now living temporarily in Bedford for one reason or another. So it could be that they're staying with relatives, could be staying in the hotel, could be staying, they would then fall into that. If they here in Bedford and they want to come to Bedford schools, we would educate them, that would be part of the McKinney-Vento. So that's, it's what's happening, what's about to happen in our neighboring town, the state has come in and said, this is what we're doing, so it's a little bit different. This is a federal law.
What if they were living in Bedford and then became homeless? Could they come back? They could stay here and live in.
Yeah, so we've had situations this school year, for example, where we have people who are living in Bedford who found temporary housing in another community. Those students continued to come to Bedford until the family found permanent housing, and then they went to school in that district where they now found permanent housing. So yes, this happens all the time. No, all the time, I shouldn't say it, but it happens. And we work very closely with our families to make sure that we do the very best for our students.
Okay. Thank you.
it's unpredictable.
Yep.
But at the same time, there are quite a few of residency issues that we come across, whether it's homelessness or otherwise. We definitely have residency challenges throughout the year.
And do these all come to you directly, Phil, or do they come to other staff?
Typically, they'll start with the principal, but it's the superintendent who makes a determination.
Okay. Just piggybacking on that, and I should know, so I'm aware that we deal with these, you know, folks that lost their housing in Bedford, live somewhere else, come here and, until they find permanent housing. So would that, in theory, extend all the way until the end of a high school if it goes on for years of displacement?
I have not seen it go on that long.
But there's no expiration date on that, on that law. It doesn't, until housing is secured, they can come to Bedford.
Yes.
Yeah. And my other question, in exception C about Bedford, children of Bedford faculty, it does say this does not apply for programs for which Bedford residents are charged tuition. Can you just explain to me what that means? Attendance shall be on a tuition-free basis, provided that the benefit shall not apply to programs for which Bedford residents are charged tuition. What does that mean? No free preschool, no district placements, I just don't know.
I believe that's what it means.
Okay.
Yes.
Both the former or the latter? I'm sorry, what does that mean?
Both, any program that will cost more.
Great, great. Thank you very much. I assume this is fine. I appreciate it. It was due for an update, so good work.
Thank you, Dan. We go to Sheila next.
Thanks. I had the same question that Dan had just asked about that tuition question, so I'm all set. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheila. And Anne?
I just appreciate the update, the fact that we're looking at it, and I think it's probably surprising to some residents that we do have homeless children and families, and it's just important that we know their rights, they know their rights, and as Sarah pointed out, it was a big issue several years ago in the town. So, thank you.
Thank you. Sarah McGinley?
I appreciate the update. I have no further questions.
Okay. Laura?
No questions.
Okay, thank you. My only question is about the issues that come to you. Is it typically quite clear in black and white in the residency policy, or is there quite a bit of gray area associated with this?
There's quite a bit of gray area.
And is this is there more that the policy could do to eliminate the gray area, or is that?
No, you're talking about people's lives,
yeah,
and they aren't black and white. So there's a lot of gray, and there's a lot of work with the principals, so no.
Okay.
This will help a little bit.
It's super fact specific. I mean, we know the law, and then based on it, and the facts vary so wide.
So the ambiguity is about the facts, not about the law, is what you're saying. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So this is a first read. So I believe, anybody want me to go around again? That seemed like it was fast. Everybody got their thing. So, okay. So I think we can move on then to our next agenda item. And I believe our next agenda item is the school choice vote. It has my name next to it, but I think you should introduce it, Phil, if you would like to. I have the text of the current policy here to read, if you'd like that to happen. Does anybody want me to read it?
My question is, was the school choice hearing posted?
Yes.
Yes, definitely.
Thank
yes.
you.
Yes.
Since or some
several,
time,
several, so, quite some time ago.
Yes, so I won't read the whole policy, but basically, let me go through it just for Sheila.
People that watch don't usually know, actually, we have questions every year.
Happy to go through it. So
please describe it.
The state of Massachusetts has an opportunity for school districts to choose to participate in a school choice program, which would allow students, in our case, it would allow students to come into Bedford if there were available seats. We have not typically participated in the past. So I'll just read you the policy, which is JFBB, school choice. It is the policy of this school district to not admit non-resident students under the terms and conditions of the Interdistrict School Choice Law, MGL 7612B. This decision will be reaffirmed each school year prior to June 1st by a vote of the school committee following a public hearing in the event the Bedford Public School Committee votes to participate. the following local conditions would apply. If we participated every May 1st of the school year, we would determine the number of spaces. By June 1st every school year, by consideration would be given to withdraw from the provision, so that's if we were doing it. That resident students be given priority placement in any classes or programs within the district, and that the selection of non-resident students for admission when the number of requests exceeds the number of available seats be done in the form of a random drawing. Any student who is accepted for admission under the provision of this policy is entitled to remain in the district until graduation from high school, except if there is a lack of funding of the program. And six, the school committee affirms its position that it shall not discriminate in the admission of any child on the basis of race, color, religion, national origin, sex, gender identity, age, sexual orientation, ancestry, athletic performance, physical handicap, special needs, academic performance, or proficiency in English language. And so the policy states that we do not admit non-resident students, and you need to vote whether to affirm that or to enter us into the inter-district school choice law, and then open our district up to out of Bedford students.
And I'd just like to add one thing, Phil, because it's in the, what's written in. You did a great summary, and I one key piece. If we were to vote now to enter into the inter-district school choice law, which would be the change in policy, then that means that, number one, by May 1st, we determine the number of spaces, you said that, and then by June 1st, if we decided we wanted to withdraw, it would be necessary to hold a public meeting to review the decision. So it's not
yep.
automatic, it's something. So. Okay, good. Any more comments you want to make about that, Phil?
Nope.
Okay, let's start with Sarah Scott.
Determine, so if you had 100 seats in your kindergarten and your Bedford, Metco, and Hanscom, although Hanscom doesn't count as an example, students were only 80, you could say we'll take 20 kindergartners. And you would do the same thing for every class, grade level, from there on up. So if your target was 150 ninth graders and you only had 125, you would say we have 25 ninth grade seats. And so you would put out all of your seat availability and then put it out. People would put their names in. If there were 30 ninth graders, then you would have to have a lottery so that you picked 25 randomly. And that's why the information at the bottom about what not, you can't discriminate. It's random, and you would do it in public. We probably would do it here at a meeting. And then you would have a full 150 ninth graders.
Would you have to post all of the grades? Yeah, so you couldn't.
You'd have to post where we said we had availability.
Wait, okay, so we could, in theory, say we only have it in. What I was worried about is that we're overflowing in some, we're at capacity in some grades and not at capacity in others. If we just said that. Anybody who come, we would make too much pressure on the high school, but that's not the case. You're saying that we could be very specific. Okay.
School choice is meant to be an empty seat program. So if you have 25 seats and you only have 20 Bedford Medco students, you have five empty seats. That's what you would put up for choice.
Thank you, Sarah. Dan?
If you don't have any questions, as you know, you've always neglected to participate in school choice. I see no reason I'll be changing my mind this year. That's just my opinion.
Sheila?
No questions.
Thank you, Sheila. Anne?
Just a question for the folks at home. If a district opts to participate in this program, how does the reimbursement comes from the sending district to the receiving district? How is the, is it a, it's a set figure, or how does that work, just so people can understand?
Yep, that's a great question, Anne. So the number is set by the state and is paid for by the sending district.
Sarah McKinnon?
I have no questions. Thank you.
Okay. Alora?
No questions.
I have two questions. The first one is the rate that's set by the state, is that the same across the entire state, or is it district specific?
I believe it's the same across the state. And if I'm not mistaken, and it's been a while since I participated in school choice, it was set at the state average, but don't know.
Okay. The other question I have is, if a student is coming in from another location, geographically, does Bedford incur any responsibility for transportation or anything like that?
No transportation is expected.
So somehow the student has to get him or herself here.
Yes, typically what happens with younger students is either a parent would bring them to school, or they might ask to, you know, bring them to the border, if you will, to where the nearest bus stop is, if there's room available on the bus, that kind of thing. But generally speaking, no transportation.
Okay. All right, thank you. Any other comments or questions that are around? No? Okay, so we do need to take a vote, correct? So
yes,
to do that, we should have a motion.
Can I just do a clarify? So
I'm sorry?
A yes on this vote means no student choice. Is that correct?
Yeah, so let's make the motion and then I'll answer that question. The language of the suggested motion here is the school committee votes, and then we can choose two or not two, so it could go either way. If you'd like to make the motion, it's the school committee votes two or not two. Participate in school choice for the 2023-2024 school year.
So I move that Bedford School Committee not participate in school choice for the 2023-2024 school year.
Okay, great. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Great. Okay. So then to clarify, a yes vote means that the current policy remains in force and we would not participate in school choice, the inter-district school choice. A no vote would mean that we would be changing our policy and I guess it would mean we would adopt the it would seem like we'd want a motion in the affirmative to do that, but right now we are affirming that we will not participate according to this message. Is that clear? What a yes vote means? Okay. All right. In that case, roll call vote. Sarah?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
Sheila?
Yes.
Anne?
I abstain.
Yes. And I will vote yes. So the motion passes 4-0 with one abstention. That concludes the school choice agenda item. And we move next to the budget. We have some iterations on the budget, so go ahead and go.
Screen if I can. Okay, so can everybody see my screen? And if you can't, it's up there on the thing. So I'm going to sharing, and I'm going to move this and move all these things around. I'm going to put it into slideshow mode. Perfect. Okay. So, and I know all of you know, and I appreciate that you were all there. I appreciate that everybody came to the finance committee the other night. As we talked about, as they talked about at Finance Committee, they had asked us to come in at 3.5% for our budget, our 3.5 increase over the FY23 budget. We had brought them in 4% increased budget, And the, I think the message was clear for us to come in at 3.5. So Julie and I have worked up a updated budget for you. And so I have a very short, but I want to go through the presentation. So the key features remain preserving strong support for district initiatives, strategically targeting BHS and JGMS for improved class sizes, ensuring class sizes stay within the school committee limits, guidelines, at Davis and Lane, the restoration of the librarian at the Lane School, providing for our special education students, and supporting content area departmental budgets. So this budget, updated budget proposal, has a 2.6% increase for our maintenance of effort, or our level services budget, with our additional support budget being 0.9, and that's the request. This revised request meets the 3.5% guideline recommended by the Finance Committee. A 0.5% is about $233,000, and that's the reduction from the previous 4% school committee approved request that we presented on the 9th to Finance Committee. So how did we do it? We took out the $150,000 in projected out-of-district tuition costs, which we would like to try to meet via a Finance Committee reserve fund transfer request that would be made later in the year, later next spring. We've also taken out the $55,000 in the potential cost for an associated 1.0 FTE elementary teacher so that we can stay within guidelines. And again, if we find ourselves outside of the guidelines, we would ask for a Finance Committee reserve fund transfer if we go outside of class size guidelines. Additionally, we will use an extra $27,398 from our circuit breaker to close the gap to get from 4.0 to 3.5% increase for the FY24 budget. So here's your FY23 budget at $45,157. Your MOE budget for FY24 at $46,322, a change of 2.6% or $1.164. The additional needs budget is an addition $471,471. I'm going to have to play that number. For an additional 9%, a 0.9% increase. And so the total is $46,737, or about $150,000, $1.5 million, or a 3.5% increase, as opposed to the 4% increase that we had presented on the 9th. The FTE, the staffing changes, and you can see there, the change here is a 0.6. with the adds and the takeaways. So the additional 5.6 provides the district's highest priority students, because this is for identified students and these have been identified in the budget process throughout the fall. And that's the shortened presentation.
Good.
Great.
Okay. We'll start with questions from Sarah Scobo.
Thank you very much for reorganizing this a little bit. I'm worried about taking money out of the circuit breaker, but that's a practice that we've done before. That is there enough left in there that will be okay?
The reason that we continue to need a reserve fund transfer is because we have spent down our circuit breaker and we are now building it back up. We haven't built it up to where we want it to be. That's why we had put it into the budget for the 150, but we'll have to go and ask for it. So will we have enough? No, we already know we don't have enough, but the 27 is a small increment in the larger picture of things.
Good. I know we've been trying to get away from the reserve fund transfer, but if this is what needs to be done, it's what needs to be done. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Sarah. Dan.
Thank you. Great to be here with the process continuing. I guess my question for Brad and Phil is, was the instruction to come in at 3.5 a surprise to you or not? Have you given a preview that that was going to be coming?
I'm happy to answer that, Brad.
Sure.
No, it was not. I was not given any heads up that that was going to be the case. We thought that our 4.0 budget was both fiscally responsible and also met the needs of the district long and short term.
Okay, no, I do agree. No, the we've been given many clues to take the reserve back. If this satisfies what we need to do, I'm happy to give it back. I guess my question, to quote a famous musician, is it all about the base? Because it feels like the fear on FinCom, which is a legitimate one, like the base continues to grow and to grow, and if it can be controlled, it must be controlled. I'm happy to participate in that kind of control if that's what they're interested in. So I guess my follow-up question to the one I just asked first, Phil, is has this idea been sounded out yet with them, and this be interesting to them as a way to get to a number which makes sense?
You mean the revision?
The revision. Has this concept been shared with Ben or other members in advance of us taking a position on it?
We have not shared it with the entire finance committee. I had a discussion with the chair of the finance committee to let him know that we were intending to bring a proposal of this nature. Of course, he cannot say what the committee as a whole is going to, how they're going to act. He seemed to think that this might be more favorably received than what we had proposed previously.
Does it seem like you're on the right day?
Sorry?
Well, at the base.
Sorry, I didn't get
the end of the article. Just kidding. So we have options. You know, at the end of the day, like we work within the system because it benefits us. We could say we want to keep all of it. I'm not there. I'm happy that if this accounting trick makes 3.5 work, I'm on board with it. I don't want to be surprised again if we're being told that doesn't count. I want this to count, right? So I think it makes perfect sense to me. If they want more flesh to come off the budget, you know, we could have that conversation. I don't want to have that this evening. So I'm happy to move forward, I think, with this one.
Thank you, Dan. Sheila.
Sure, thanks. And Phil, thanks for the summary of what we changed. And we were all at FinCom last week, so it was great to just hear their questions and thoughts on this process. From my understanding, and I just would like to verify, for both of those costs, for the reserve teacher and the out-of-district funds, it's my understanding that, in fact, we do need those funds, and that is not in our budget. We are able to request that funding, and reasonably so, because it would be managing classroom sizes, or from a legal perspective, if a student has to go out of district and we have to pay tuition, then in fact we will be able to access that money. But the premise is that they're just keeping it sort of in control of in their account versus passing it to us at the beginning. Is that a correct assessment?
Yeah, we would need to go and ask them for the money. You know, they understand how our budget works. They've been very good to us. They've listened carefully to all of our presentations over the last few years. So I think that what we would do is go and request the funds. And as I say, we have had a good relationship with them. And my expectation is they'll understand what's going on and go from there.
Okay, thank you. No further questions.
Thank you, Sheila. Anna's next.
Just a comment. These revisions, when you look at them procedurally, make sense, but practical and pragmatic. I think it's a good approach, and it promotes some relationships with FinCom going forward, should the need arise. It works, so thank you.
Okay, thank you. Sarah?
My questions are answered, thank you.
Laura?
No questions.
Okay, great. And my questions were answered also. So, suggestion, motion language is the school committee votes, oh, that's the wrong one, sorry, we're gonna redo the, this one. The school committee approved the revised FY '24 budget to meet the requests of the finance committee. It was,
Do we need the dollar amount and everything?
We could, that was not in the suggested motion language, but.
I think we actually have to vote this specific number.
We should do that.
That's on the bottom line budget presentation, if you want to vote.
Oh, yep.
Yep.
Read out that, right.
Say that, please, voice.
You wanna put that slide up?
Yep. I don't know what happens, I'm gonna try again.
Hey, buddy, it's like Paul.
That's the wrong one.
I can state the number if you'd like.
Yeah, please.
Okay.
Say this all the time.
$46,737,588.
Okay.
Would be the total requested FY '24 budget bottom line.
Okay, great, so, could we please have a motion for the school committee to approve the revised FY '24 budget at $46,737,588 to meet the requests of the finance?
So moved.
And a second, please?
Second.
Thank you so much. A roll call vote, Sarah Scolden.
Yes.
Dan.
Yes.
Sheila.
Yes.
Ann.
Yes.
And I, Brad votes yes, the motion passes 5-0.
When do you bring that back to them?
And thank you for asking, the, in anticipation of this action tonight, I asked the finance committee for time on their agenda for their meeting this Thursday, so they can keep the process moving along, because things have to happen after this budget gets approved next, so, Phil will be presenting that on Thursday, and it would be a great time for any or all of us to show up and provide support if we are available. Okay?
Thank you.
Yep. Great, next on the agenda is, where is my agenda? Next is the superintendent report. Mr. Conley.
Happy to do it. So, a number of things going on, I wanted to just wish our counselors a great week, I hope they had a great week last week during National School Counselor Week, which was the 6th and the 10th, first full week of the month of February each year. The vertical choral concert is tomorrow night at 7:00 at the high school, and the orchestra and band vertical concerts are coming up, and those will be in the newsletter on Friday. Congratulations to BHS alum Natalie Lewis, who won the first prize at the Houston Grand Opera Concert of Arias event. Want to invite everybody to Thursday evening's Black History Month event, sponsored by Medco and the Parent Diversity Council. Dr. Jamil Adams will be here, step performances, and there will be soul food available as well. Want to thank everybody who participated in the Citizen Scholarship Foundation Bedford Dollars for Scholars virtual trivia night, and thank everyone for that, and remind everyone that the BEF is having their black and white birthday bash on Saturday the 4th of March at Cafe Escadrille over in Burlington. Want to congratulate all of our students who participated in National History Day Fair projects, and there'll be a link to the History Day Fair projects in this week's letter. To save the dates for school committee members particularly, but for Medco families, we will be at Medco headquarters on the 14th of March in Nubian Square, and there'll be more information about that. And for our Hanscom families, we will be on base on the 19th of May as part of our celebration of the Military Child Month, which is the month of May. We do have a legal opinion, which I have shared with you via email, about hybrid and in-person meetings going forward after the 31st of this month.
Next month.
Next month, sorry, next month. I wanted to give a shout out to Reverend John Castricum. There is the Reverend and his some of her parishioners are reading Permission to Feel, which is the book that is based on our RULA program at the JGMS. And John has come in and talked to people at the middle school about it and was thrilled about the book and is doing a book club that meets on Wednesday nights. And I know that he said all are welcome to that. And then finally, I want to give a shout out to the BHS administration and teachers for their investigation of the graffiti incident that we had here at the high school a week ago Monday. I know that the administrators and the teachers did a great job not only discovering what had happened, but also caring for all of those affected. And I truly appreciate all of their hard work to make sure that that incident was taken care of. And so that is the superintendent's report.
All right. Thank you, Phil. Sarah Scobie.
Can you say the Hanscom date again in May?
I can. The Hanscom date is May 19th. And is that the wrong date?
It's a Friday.
Oh, then it shouldn't be. It should be the 16th.
You aren't scheduled to be on the 16th.
Oh, I take it back.
Maybe
all
the 9th?
Together. It's the 9th.
Yeah,
and you're right. Okay. Sorry, 9th. 5-9. I wrote it down wrong.
Awesome. Okay, perfect. Thank you for all the updates. That's the only question I have.
Thank you, Sarah. Dan.
I'm thrilled to be going on the road again. Those were great meetings last year. I'm very excited to go again. And Akil, I remember the movie got me in Boston. So, and look for a second. If you're watching Akil.
Is that it?
Yep.
It's really okay.
Serious question.
Thank you very much. Next up is Sheila.
Thanks for the updates, Phil. No questions.
And next is Aya.
No questions.
Sarah McKinley.
No questions, but I have a clarification. I think Phil, you said May is the month of the military child. It's always been April. So I just wanted to clarify. It's
yep.
The meeting is May 9th, but the month of the military child is in purple.
April.
Is
April. Yeah, you're right.
And that's it.
Thank you.
Okay. And Laura?
No questions.
I have no questions, and we don't need to act on that, right? So,
nope.
That brings us to our next item, which is the superintendent search update. So I'll just do a little summary of some things that have been going on. I don't think there's a lot that's news, but let me summarize things. As most people know, the school committee has been working to get to know the four finalists that were recommended by the screening committee. Each of those four finalist candidates came to visit the district for a day, and during that day they had meetings and opportunities to meet with a group of different stakeholders in the school districts, including students, teachers, administrators, and others. There was also a family forum involved in that, and then was interviewed publicly by the school committee. The video and audio recordings of those candidate interviews are all up on the superintendent search website for anyone who wants to watch them. There is also a set of four links that you can go to enter your comments as any member, any stakeholder member of the Bedford community more broadly. So please do that, and we're going to keep those links open until the end of day. Today's Tuesday, already, right? So the end of day tomorrow. In addition to that in-person visit, the candidates have also participated in some Zoom meetings to allow other people who weren't able to join in person to have access to conversations with those candidates. There was a pretty massive 4 hours in a row last night of one candidate at, for each hour. And those are also recorded and posted on the superintendent search website for anyone who wants to review those. The reason we are asking to get the information in by tomorrow, if you have comments to make about it, it's a free text question, so basically anything you want to write about any one of the four candidates, just choose the candidate that you want to comment about, and then survey will allow you to do that. I've started reading some of the ones that are coming in. I certainly have not read all of them. There's lots to read because we've had great participation and enthusiasm from the community on this. We need to sort of have time to read those. So if anybody needs a little more time than tomorrow, please reach out and let us know. It's not like it's a deadline where things drop dead if it doesn't happen, but we do want to keep the process moving. Other parts of the process that are occurring, an important part of it is that the school committee members have all agreed on some assignments to follow up by checking references of each of the four finalist candidates. So that's an ongoing process that will be unfolding over the next week or so. That has begun, and that information, of course, as everyone would understand, will be kept private and confidential, and out of respect for the privacy of all the candidates, and to make the reference checking process itself an authentic and sincere one. And then we have an agenda item for our next meeting, which is 2 weeks from tonight, for that date is February 28th, to review it all and vote to decide how we want to move forward. So I believe that's everything. Sarah, have I left anything out of the process summary? I'm looking to my colleague in crime over there for running going through this subcommittee. So questions or comments? Sarah?
Amount of work Brad and Sarah have been doing, but I appreciate it. And let's do two more reasons and see what happens.
Thank you. Sheila?
No questions, thank you.
Ann?
I just want to thank all the parents and staff that participated in the interviews last evening. I sat and listened to them, and I was very impressed with how many folks participated. There were some really great questions, and I think the candidates really appreciated it, and more than one commented that they were pleasantly surprised how many people. So I just want to thank everyone for doing that. It was incredibly helpful.
Great. Thank you, Ann. Sarah McKinley.
No questions.
And Alora?
No questions.
Yes. Yes, and let me echo what Ann just said about the thanks and gratitude to everybody who participated. And any part of this process, I will say that in different ways, each of the four candidate finalists has said that the process has been has made them want to be in Bedford even more. So represented ourselves well with thoughtful and sincere questions that represent the values of the community. So it's very important. Okay, I think that ends the superintendent search update. So our next item is minutes. I believe we have three sets of minutes here today. So let me just find which ones they are. Minutes. Yes, so the first one is the minutes of the January 17th meeting. Does anybody have any comments or questions about that one? I'm just going to dose this out. Okay. So could we have a motion to approve the minutes of January 17th?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Roll call vote. Sarah Scoville?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
Sheila?
Yes.
Ann?
Yes.
And Brad votes yes, so we have a 5-0. We also have minutes for our January 24th, 2023. Any corrections, comments that you did not already submit? Could we have a motion to approve the minutes of January 24th, 2023 as submitted?
So moved.
And second?
Second.
Okay. So roll call vote. Sarah?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
Sheila?
Yes.
Ann?
Yes.
And I vote yes, so 5-0. And the last set of minutes is from February 2nd. Any updates on the corrections? Okay. Could we have a motion to approve the minutes of February 2nd, 2023? And a second, please.
Second.
Okay. Roll call vote. Sarah?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
Dan, Sheila?
Yes.
And Ann?
Yes.
And I vote yes, so the minutes are approved, 5-0. That is the end of the items on the agenda. Anybody have anything else they want to bring up before we adjourn to our executive session?
I don't want to really bring this up. What's happening with the discussion about school start times? I get pinged on it every now and again. We did talk about it. someone said something about a process, I just want to see if anything's going on.
Could I comment?
Yeah, please go ahead.
So the Board of Health remains interested, and I spoke with folks last week and explained we were in the process of completing our superintendent search, completing the budget process, but yet this issue was top of mind, and that after, in all likelihood, March, April, we would start that discussion, but it's going to be a lengthy discussion, but we appreciate the work. It's not that we don't believe it's a priority. This was just been an incredibly busy 2 months, and so work this process is completed with that opportunity to start. Thank you.
And Lana, that's worth noting as Anne steps off the committee, so we'll need to fill that role as a liaison to the Board of Health.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we will need that. That's right. Anybody else? All right, in that case, I would like to entertain a motion to adjourn into executive session for the purpose of discussing strategy with respect to collective bargaining, not to open to the public.
So moved.
Thank you. And a second?
Second.
Okay, roll call vote. Sarah?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
Sheila?
Yes.
Anne? And I vote yes. So the meeting is adjourned, and we will go into executive session for the purpose of discussing strategy with respect to collective bargaining. And a Zoom call.